Good morning and welcome to First United Methodist Church, Lake Charles. I'm Katie Black. I'm the associate pastor here, and we're so glad that you are here with us this morning on this Labor Day weekend. If you're a first-time visitor, we want to extend a special word of welcome to you, and we hope that you'll stop by our welcome center just outside these doors where we do have a small gift for you, and we are so glad that you're here with us. I have a couple of announcements to bring to our attention this morning. Our new Bible study on Ruth will start next Monday, September 9th at 10 a.m., or on Tuesday evenings at September 10th at 6 p.m. And it'll continue on Mondays and Tuesdays for 6 weeks. We'll meet in room 109, which is just across from Paxton Hall. And the books that cost $12. Guys, Monday night steak night and football will be up for next Monday, September 9th at 6 p.m. in Paxton Hall. And it's for the Texans versus the Saints. So please sign up at the Welcome Centers just outside, and it'll be in Paxton Hall. Or you can call the church office to make your reservation. We'll have a great steak dinner, and we'll watch part of the Saints game, and it costs $10. Football season is here. And we want to invite you to join us for a tailgate prior to the Saturday, September 14th game. I'm so sorry, right before the Alcorn State game. It'll be from 3:30 to 5 p.m. at the Wesley Foundation. So we hope that you come and support the Cowboys and also support the McNeese Wesley Foundation. There'll be music, food, fun, and games. So invite a friend and join us. And then finally, our steak night, I'm going to just keep giving the same announcements over and over. Our Cajun night is coming up on September 22nd from 5 to 6:30 p.m. in Paxton Hall. We'll have Zida Kane come and visit with us, and they'll be playing some Cajun music and swamp pop music for us. The Cajun night itself is free, but if you would like to have some jambalaya dinner, our youth are doing a jambalaya fundraiser dinner, and the cost is $7 a plate, and the youth are selling tickets just outside these doors. At this time, I'd like to invite Jeff Lyons to come up to say a few words about an opportunity for service and for caretaking of the grounds.
Good morning. I'm Jeff Lyons from the second service, far, far away in another land over here. So I kind of have some bad news. I'm the only person I know of that's taking care of the grounds on the trimming of the crepe myrtles, the bushes, the seeding, fertilizing, manicuring, things like that. And I'm kind of getting older, and I'm looking for help in transitioning some of this stuff to other people or in joining in a team with this, because it's just getting to be, things are growing more, we're more prolific, and we have a lot to do. And the groundskeeping people do not cut bushes, and we can't get anybody to do this. So I'm recruiting people that if you have a green thumb or you're a gardener or you have a team that wants to help out, we would really appreciate that. It only takes about an hour. Once in a while, and you would be a really, really good help to us if you can do that. So if you know anybody who likes to do that, you want to do that, please let me know or contact the church office. Now, there is some good news with this, too. That's the bad news. The good news is Weldon has graciously authorized the doubling of my salary for this, and you will be enjoined with that salary increase as well, whoever joins me with that. So that's a good thing. Where's Weldon? Is it? More good news. I woke up this morning and I looked at my email and I won the Canadian lottery, believe it or not. I'm telling you. So I am graciously going to donate, bringing in a crew from Mamou every 2 weeks. I'm going to fly them in and they can take care of the bushes and stuff like that too. So if that doesn't work out, we're back to square one. So again, if you have teens or anyone would like to learn a little bit about gardening, etc., please, please, please contact the church office, or my number's in the bulletin as well, and your help would be greatly appreciated. We just have something to pass down, and people who have come to the church before us have taken care of it, but everybody seems to be getting better, so busier. So please think about it. If you know somebody who wants to help, let us know. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. As Mila comes forward to light our Christ candle, let us open with a word of prayer. Gracious God, as your air fills our lungs, we open our eyes on this beautiful morning. Let our lips praise you in word, in song, and in deed. Lord, we are here to worship you, the light of the world. Please bless this worship in the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Katie. Let's stand to our feet together. Look across the room, see if there's someone you don't recognize. Greet them with the love of God. Say hello. So we're going to teach you all a new song this morning, and we hope that you sing along with us. It reminds us that we are to rejoice in the Lord no matter what comes our way, no matter what's happening. We should find a reason to rejoice in our Lord. Here's how a little bit of it goes. It says, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say, again I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say, again I say, rejoice. All right, and when we get to that part, we hope y'all sing it with us. Bless the Lord, come bless the Lord, draw near to worship, praise the Lord, and bless His name, His holy name, declaring He is good. Come bless the Lord, come bless the Lord,
come bless the Lord, draw near to worship, praise the Lord, and bless His name, His holy name, declaring He is good.
Bless the Lord, draw near to worship, praise the Lord, and bless His name, His holy name, declaring He is good.
Again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say, again, I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say
morning. He's worthy to be praised. Come on, let's clap our hands all over this house. Lately I've been reeling, watching the nightly news. Don't seem to find the rhythm, just wanna sing the blues. Feels like a song that never stops. Feels like it's never gonna. Gotta get that fire back in my bones before my heart turns into stone. Could somebody please pass the megaphone? I'll shout it on the count of three. 1, 2, 3. Oh, give my bread and wine, I'm singing to the sky. Give me strength to raise my voice, let me testify. Oh, give my bread and wine, I'm singing to a dime.
The time has come to
make a choice, and I choose
God.
Let it move you. Let it move you. Let it move you. Yeah, I choose. Let it move. Let it move you. Let it move you. Yeah, back when I was younger, my eyes are full of life. But now that I am older, I live at the speed of light. Feels like a cycle never stops. Feels like it's never gonna. Gotta get that fire. Oh, my heart turns into stone. So won't somebody please pass the megaphone? I'll shout it on the count of three. Sing it with us. Oh, give my bread a night, I'm singing to the sky. Give me strength to raise my voice, let me testify. Oh, give my bread a night,
cause this is do or die. The time has come to make a choice,
and I choose. Down in my heart, down in my heart to stay. I need that joy, 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 joy.
Down in my heart, down in my heart to stay.
Amen. You may be seated. Hope you believe all of that this morning, and also the message that we're going to hear today, all about that, about joy. Joy in times of good times, trouble, bad times, whatever you're facing, there is joy to be found in our Lord. It's our time of giving right now. So as we prepare to do this, we hope you sing along with us, even as you're giving in this moment. It's a very simple song, and it reminds us that God forever reigns. He's good. He's good. He's our peace. He's true. He's our joy. After we sang it a couple of times, I think he'll be able to sing along with us. Let's worship our God together.
You are good. You are good when there's nothing good in me. You are love.
are good.
You are good, you are good. When there's nothing good in me, you are love on display for all to see. You are light when the darkness closes in. You are whole, you have covered all my sin.
You are peace,
you are peace.
Forever rain. there's many types of worship. We can raise our voice in the song. We can give our tithes and offering. We can volunteer and help others. But one of the easiest ways to worship is to pray. Would you join me now? God, I thank you for this wonderful day. Every day is a wonderful day because you made it. No matter what the struggles are that we're going through, no matter what difficulties we face, whether we feel alone or completely overwhelmed, God, we can find joy in the day and help us to pause and be thankful for it and call it a wonderful day. That's how I start every one of my prayers. And I'm so blessed to be able to come to you today and lead this congregation in a prayer to you as we lift up our thoughts, our concerns, our prayers, our struggles, our joys. You're there through every one of them, God. Whether it be someone passing away or a new life being born into this world. Whether it be great news of healing or a pending diagnosis. Or even that diagnosis that already came in and was not what we wanted to hear. God, we know that we can come to you in everything. All day, every day, not just on Sunday. And I'm so thankful for that gift that we have to be able to talk to you. Everyone in this room today, God, I lift them up to you right now. Those that are worshiping with us online, those that just can't be here today. You know their heart, you know their thoughts, you know their struggles, you know their joys. And I thank you for that. I give praise to you in everything that we do, everything that we have, and everything that we experience. Let us find joy. In Jesus' precious name, I ask all these things. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Melanie. Let's stand together. We're going to sing a familiar song to us. So I hope you sing along with this morning. Mighty to Save. We're going to hear a wonderful message this morning about how, as we, people of faith, should respond when we're facing trouble, hard times. And as the songs that we sang this morning remind us that there is a chance always to choose joy, to reach for joy, to reach for hope, to look up to our God, because he is, as this song says, mighty to save. With us, everyone needs compassion.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior.
He's the hope.
He is mighty to save, forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave, and Jesus conquered the grave.
Rejoice! So take me. Fears and failures.
All my fears and failures.
Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in.
And right now.
Now I surrender.
Hallelujah. He's our Savior. Sing it.
Savior. He can move.
My God is mighty
to
God for what our Lord and Savior has done for us. He didn't stay in the grave, but he got up just to assure that we would be reconnected with the Father. And just as we were dead in the grave, God has called us to rise and be his people, to be his light, his example. Come on, let's sing it. Shine your light, yeah.
Let the whole world see.
Cause we're singing. Oh,
He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation.
He rose and conquered the grave.
Comes from James chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes scattered among the nations, greetings. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. The second reading comes from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of our God. Not only so, we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Ty, for doing our scripture reading for today. Here's a good question. Did Jesus have any brothers and sisters? The answer is yes. That's pretty clear from the gospel accounts of his life. In fact, all four gospels say that. Here's one example. Mark chapter 6, verse 3. A crowd of people asked the question one day, isn't this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon, and are his sisters here with us? According to the gospel accounts, Jesus had brothers and sisters. But during his ministry, they didn't believe in him because they had seen him grow up as a little boy. They had seen him grow up as a teenager. And now at the age of 30 plus, he was claiming to be the Son of God. They didn't believe in him until after he was crucified. And then 3 days later, he came back to life and they saw him alive again. A certain brother of his, by the name of James, so believed in him that he became a leader in the early church, and he was the pastor of the church in Jerusalem. He's the person who wrote this letter of James in the New Testament. It was probably written around the year 50 AD, that would make this book the earliest book of the New Testament that was written, except for the book of Galatians. Our series of sermons here at First Methodist Church is called Journey Through James. And so for 11 Sundays, we'll go chapter by chapter, verse by verse, all the way through this small book of the Bible. It's 5 chapters long. Now here's what I hope. I hope that all of us in this worship center today and everybody in the church today is going to read this letter of James sometime in the next few days and weeks. It's 5 chapters long. It won't take you long. It takes, from what I Googled, 20 minutes to read the letter of James. So I hope that all of us will read the letter of James in the coming weeks and that God will speak to us in very powerful ways as we do that. It's one of the first books written in the New Testament, and in my opinion, it's one of the best books. God will speak to us as we read and study his word together. The first 3 verses of the book of James go like this. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes scattered among the nations, greetings. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Isn't that a strange way to begin a letter that you're writing to somebody else? Consider it pure joy when troubles come your way. I want to share with us this morning 2 important things about troubles in our lives from the letter of James. Here they are at the very beginning. Number 1, troubles come to all of us without exception. And number 2, our troubles and our problems can actually be good for us. Let's think about the first thing. According to the scripture, trouble is a constant part of life. Now, people today really don't like hearing that because our culture is all about happiness. Our culture is all about pleasure. Facebook is all about, oh, check this out and see what happened to me in this little 30-second increment of time of my 24-hour day, and look how good everything was for me in this 30-second period of time. Click, post, everything is good and happy. In a 3-month period of time, Amazon turned out over 1,000 books about happiness. Now, happiness is great, but it's not always there. A couple of weeks ago, I talked about a famous author, Scott Beck, and a book that he wrote entitled The Road Less Traveled. His book begins with 3 words, life is difficult. Isn't that the truth? Life is difficult. Let me tell you about a group of people today who never have any troubles. They don't have any worries. They don't have any fears. They have no stress. It's a pretty large group of them, in fact. They're located just a couple of blocks from here, going up Broad Street. There's a nice gate around where they live. It's called Orange Grove Cemetery. Those people have no worries, no stress, no fear, no anxiety, because they're dead. Those of us who are alive have troubles, and we have stress, and we have problems. It's a constant part of life. It's a price we pay for being alive. Back in the 1980s, a rock band called The Police had a pretty good song called King of Pain. Here's about 1:15 from their video. Could you hear his words? There's a little black spot on the sun today, and he calls himself the King of Pain. That's true for all of us here today. It's not true for those people at Orange Grove Cemetery. It's true for us who are living and breathing. We all face it. A young kid told his grandmother one day how happy he was to see her. He said, "Perhaps Daddy is now going to do his trick that he's always talking about now that you're here." His grandmother, curious, said, "What trick is that?" "Well, he told Mommy that he would climb the walls if you came to visit again." All of us eventually climb the walls. All of us eventually struggle and we face problems. The book of Job in the Old Testament is all about suffering. It's all about trouble. Chapter 5, verse 7 of Job says that trouble is like a part of life, like sparks shooting skyward. Jesus even promised us, John chapter 16, he said, "In the world you will have trouble." It's a false gospel that says, and we've heard it before, if you only have enough faith and trust in the Lord, everything in your life is going to be good and wonderful. I got to tell you, that is a false gospel. It's not true. Everybody eventually struggles, even devout Christians. It's so important for us here today to get this, because being a Christian doesn't mean that I'm going to beat every cancer and find harmony in every relationship and always make the winning shot at the end of the basketball game. That's not the deal. But here is the deal. God is with us, even in the challenging days and the painful times. God is with us, even in the dark valleys of life. Paul said, when troubles come your way. He didn't say if troubles come your way, when troubles come your way. Now, a second truth from the book of James. Those troubles and those problems that come to our lives can actually be good for us. Those troubles and those problems that we're experiencing, even though we can't stand it at the moment, those things can be good for us. I want us to hear again the words of James. He said, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, when trials come your way, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance." A man by the name of Leslie Weatherhead was a famous Methodist pastor in London in the mid-1900s. He wrote several excellent books, including a book entitled The Will of God. Leslie Weatherhead had some major disappointments in his life, and here's what he wrote during one of those dark periods. He said, "I can only write down this simple testimony. Like everybody else, I love and prefer the sunny uplands of experience when health and happiness abound." Then listen carefully to what he said. "I've learned more about God and life and myself in the darkness of fear and failure than I've ever learned in the sunshine. The darkness, thank God, passes. But those things that we learn in the darkness, we possess forever." The longest chapter in the Bible is Psalm 119. An interesting verse in that chapter affirms this: "It is good for me that I was afflicted, that I might learn your statutes." King David said, "It's good for me that I was afflicted, that I might learn the laws of God." So think about this question for just a minute this morning. Are you facing some kind of darkness in your life today? Are you having some real struggles going on? If that's the case, I pray that God will encourage you and strengthen you and help you to get through whatever difficult time you are facing, and then after it's all said and done, to learn from it. The words of that Methodist pastor in England are so true. Those things that we learn in the darkness, we possess forever. An old Arab proverb says, "All sunshine makes a desert." Here's what the Apostle Paul said in the book of Romans, chapter 5. He said, "Not only that, we boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us." And that means this very simply: our problems and our sufferings and our trials can actually be good for us. I love the writings of Mitch Albom. The last name is spelled A-L-B-O-M. His most famous book is called Tuesdays with Morrie. In that great little book, he talked about his favorite college teacher who was dying of Lou Gehrig's disease and about his going to visit with that teacher every Tuesday during this man's illness, hence the title, Tuesdays with Morrie. His teacher, whose name was Morrie, said to him one day something that he wrote down and that's so important. Here's what he said. It's hard to explain, Mitch, but now that I'm suffering, I feel closer to other people who suffer than I ever did before. I feel their anguish as if it were my own. I'm just saying somehow, in some way, suffering changes us and it opens up our heart. James said, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, when trials come your way. You ever heard of Dave Trevecki? He's a great Christian writer, but he was also an incredible pitcher for the San Diego Padres and the San Francisco Giants till he got really sick with cancer in his throwing arm. I want us to hear a couple of sentences that he wrote in his excellent book that was entitled When You Can't Come Back. Dave Trevecki said, one night a lady came up to me after a speech and told me that she was once down and out with a drug addiction until somebody told her about Christ. Then she became a Christian and she was healed of her addiction. And after that, she told me that God wanted all of his children to be 100% healthy. And in the book, Dave asked this question, but does he? How would God's children actually turn out and grow up, he said, if all the bumps in the road ahead of them were smooth? He continues, cancer introduced me to suffering, and suffering is what strengthened my faith. Now that's a powerful statement. Cancer introduced me to suffering, and suffering is what strengthened my faith. Our scripture for today says, consider it pure joy when troubles come your way. Our troubles and our problems can actually be good for us. In writing this sermon for today, I thought about some times in my own life that I have been somewhat knocked to the ground and had some trouble or some suffering. Thought about the death of my parents and a long hospital stay when I had a ruptured appendix when I was in Monroe. Some other things that I wouldn't talk about from up here. So here's the question. Did I like those days of suffering? Did I like those days of trouble? Absolutely not. I hated every minute of it when I was going through it. But I know that I'm stronger today and I'm better today because of those challenging days. That is what God does. Paul said suffering produces endurance. Endurance produces character. Character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us. Glenn Cunningham became the fastest human being in the whole world in a mile race. But he was so badly burned when he was a little boy at the age of 8 in a terrible accident that happened at school. His doctors claimed that he would never walk again, that he would always be in a wheelchair. But 2 years after this horrible accident, he took his first steps. And he worked, and he struggled, and he put his trust in God. He kept on saying over and over again a verse from the Bible, from the prophet Isaiah, that goes like this, but those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall rise up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And his whole life was turned around from an 8-year-old boy, burned, crippled, in a wheelchair with no hope, to the fastest human being in the whole world. Two facts of life from the letter of James. Number one, trouble is a constant part of life. And number two, those troubles can actually be good for us. Hear again the word of God for today. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kind, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. And that's the word of God for us this day. Let us pray. Lord, we need to hear this word today because we are living and breathing, and because of that, struggles and problems and suffering are always a part of our life. So, Lord, speak to us this day the word that we need to hear about troubles, and bring us to faith in you. And now, Lord, we come to this table this morning to celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion. We come to this table because you have invited us and you have called us. We know we don't deserve it because we have sinned and fallen short. So we come to you for mercy and for forgiveness. As we come to this table, we're joined with believers down through the centuries who have done this very same thing that we're doing this morning, remembering the body of Christ, which was broken for us, and the blood of Christ, which was poured out for us. May this truly be a holy time in our lives. Make this be for us the body and the blood of Christ, and make us instruments of your peace to all the world through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. The Lord's table is now prepared, and the invitation to Holy Communion is for everybody in this worship center today. You don't have to be a member of First United Methodist Church to come to the Lord's table. You don't have to be a member of any church. Everybody in this worship center is invited and welcome to attend to be a part of this sacrament. I'm going to ask those who are serving to please come first, and then you come as the ushers direct.
There was so much on my mind.
I was searching for that peace, a peace I could not find. So then I knelt down to pray. Pray, Lord, help me, please. Then he said, you don't have to cry. Soon as I stop worrying, worrying how the story ends, I let go when I let God. Let him have his way. That's when things start happening, and I stop looking at back then. There's so much going on sometimes, I can't find my way, and oftentimes I struggle from day to day. I have to realize that it's not battle to fight. I know I have to put it in his hands, and that everything would be right. And soon as I stop worrying how the story ends, I let go and I let. Let God have his way. That's when things start happening. I stop looking at back then. I let go when I let God. Let him have his way. Let go. Let God, let go, and let God, let go, let God, let go. Doesn't matter what the problem is, just let go. The story would end, I let go and I let God. Let him have his way. And that's when things start happening, I stop looking at back then. I let go and I let God. Let God have his way.
Would you please stand? As we close this morning, we extend to you the invitation to Christian discipleship. If the Lord is leading you to give your heart and life to Christ today, to unite membership at First United Methodist Church, I invite you to come forward as we worship and sing together.
Francis,
Salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Shine your light, shine your light, let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light, let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory.
She comes this morning to join from another United Methodist Church here in town, a fine United Methodist Church that she's been real happy in. But her family comes here, and she wants to worship and be a part of the church where her family is. And so she's worshiped here so many times, and we know and love Miss Francis and her family, and so glad to welcome her into First United Methodist Church. I'm going to ask her to stay up here at the altar of the church to give you a chance to come by and greet her and officially welcome Miss Francis into membership here. Miss Francis, on behalf of everybody, we're so glad to have you officially. I've considered you a member, but officially as a member at First United Methodist. Next Sunday, we continue our series of sermons on the letter of James. We have 11 to go. Your job is to just start reading through the letter of James a little bit at a time. Next week is the question, what is real religion? James tells us what real religion is at the end of chapter 1. Hope you have a wonderful week. Look forward to seeing you in the Lord's house next Sunday morning. Thank you.